Hi, I'm Reed, this is Crowland Publishing, and welcome back to Lore, which is part of our series where we take folklore, religion, social custom, all that sort of cool stuff, and drain it for our needs as tabletop role-playing game designers. Today we are doing fungi, mushrooms. So I live in Australia, regional, out in the middle of nowhere. It's very cold and very rainy right now, which is not bad considering that about 5 months ago, every bloody thing was on fire. But yesterday, I'm walking the dog, and I saw a ring of mushrooms, a toadstool ring, which in the old days they called a fairy ring, which led me to thinking about the folklore of fungus. Fungus plays a unique role in fantasy fiction. It's often a symbol of horror and otherness, from the creepy mushroom people of Vandermeer's ambergris stories to the fungal imagery of Hellboy and its Lovecraftian monstrosities. Fungi is often a symbol of something is creepy, something is wrong, and also fungus has really, really cool names. So you take something like the quite creepy-looking strawberry and cream fungi, or you take the devil's tooth, or you take the prince, the bridal veil, the bleeding flower, the bleeding tooth fungus, the red juice tooth, or my favourite, white brain jelly fungus. White brain jelly fungus is worth a like. Smash that like button, as they say. So you've already got this really quite evocative lore around fungi. So we're going to take five little interesting bits of fungi folklore, and they're very, very broad categories. We're normally more specific, but there's so much mushroom and fungus folklore going on, and we're going to spin five adventure ideas out of them. Now, we're just talking about folklore, but if you're really interested, you might want to go and read some science about mushrooms and fungi because, well, fungus intelligence, at the very least, is super, super weird, and you probably already know about the zombie funguses. So anyway, let's get into it. Number one. Fungi is often used as medicine. You probably know about bread mold being used as antibiotics, but from the Stone Age to today, fungus is still used as medicine. Sometimes it was very, very important, rare, and expensive medicine. For example, the stinkhorn, or as it's sometimes known, the Phallus impudicus, has been used in Europe to treat rheumatism, epilepsy, gout, even skin cancer. It's a good and effective medicine, but it had a dark side. Sometimes it was blamed for cholera. Sometimes it was blamed for outbreaks of madness. Puffballs, my all-time favorite. I love them. You squeeze them and spores come flying out of them. And that was used to staunch the flow of blood from wounds or nosebleeds. Very, very effective and useful medicine. Beekeepers to this day use the spores of giant puffballs to blow into the hives, which will narcotize the bees and allow them to get honey. Fungus was known. It was collected, it was farmed, and it was considered an important resource. If folk medicine's in your game, fungus is in your game. Number two, there's a belief, specifically an English belief, that mushrooms were very, very deadly if a toad used the mushroom as a stool. There you go. If a toad sits on a mushroom, it becomes a very, very dark poison. And indeed, at the dark of the moon, mushrooms, no matter what the toad is doing, becomes quite poison. So only a very wise person could correctly understand where the fungus was in its life cycle. And I think that it's if the moon is full, it's poison. If the moon is dark, you're okay. My grandmother used to think the toads were venomous, and she told me that in the 1980s. So this really, really hung on, this idea that things change according to the actions of supernatural agents around the moon, toads, and of course toads, witches, familiars, you're getting the idea. So fungus changes, fungus is mutable, fungus is wild. Which brings us to number three, the links between witchcraft, especially witchcraft trials, and fungi. Now, ergo poisoning is long been suspected as one of the reasons that the witchcraft trials exist in the first place. Now, I'm more of a Caliban and the witch kind of guy when it comes to explaining the witch trials, but listen to this. Dementia, facial distortions, hallucinations, convulsions, and paralysis. These are very, very commonly reported in witch trial logs and transcripts that were taken in the courts. These are also symptoms of ergo poisoning, which is just a kind of fungus which gets into wheat and then can get into the house. Over and over again in witchcraft trials, we see allegations against farm animals. Now, farm animals are vital to life in the Middle Ages and in the early modern times. And if your cattle stops producing milk, you can be in real trouble. And so you blame the witch next door. But here's the thing. That is a classic example of ergo poisoning. even animals acting crazy is they're mammals. They still can go and get dementia like what a human can from ergo poisoning. So this fungus has profoundly affected the way that we experience supernatural evil as a species. Number four, hallucinogens, what we're all here for. Now, hallucinogens and hallucinogenics are very, very important to folklore and mythology all around the world, and specifically a mushroom called fly agaric. Soma, which was a sort of god plant worshipped in ancient Hindu culture, very, very important, probably fly agaric. This mushroom was known to the Koyak tribesmen in Siberia, where we actually get the word shaman from. Now, they would drink an infusion from this fungus and become so intoxicated and experience powerful, powerful magical trances and big visions of Big Raven, their totem. It was such a potent drink that actual shaman urine became used as a medicine. Viking berserkers, you've heard about them. Rah! They might have been on mushrooms as well. The Mayans and the pre-Mayan civilizations of Central America, now they left behind rock carvings that we call mushroom stones, which we now believe are them doing hallucinogenic mushrooms in their sometimes quite bloodthirsty rituals. They also seem to have had a culture of taking drugs just for fun, just like we do. So mushrooms are really, really central to the experience of going out of your body and experiencing otherness, of encountering magical intelligences and spirits and entities. And for number five, fairy traditions and mushrooms. Now, I don't know about you, but maybe my entire fascination with all this stuff was caused by being told that a ring of mushrooms, commonly occurring thing, is a gateway into fairyland. Now, I've jumped into 1,000 rings of mushrooms, but sadly I've rarely been to the other world. However, Celtic otherland and Celtic fairyland is a very, very strange place. King Arthur mythology is based on all these really, really strange Celtic myths, and fairyland is sometimes hell, a place called Ufen, the land of the dead. Shakespeare actually says the mushrooms are planted by elves, which I actually haven't seen any existing folklore to back that up, but I mean, the dude didn't work in a vacuum. So maybe these fairy rings are actually an attempt by the fairies, by these other intelligences, to lure us into their territory. I don't know, but again, mushrooms are over and over and over a symbol of otherness, a symbol of something else, something that is different from the world that we live in. So anyway, there's five bits of fairy folklore. Let's get five adventure ideas out of it. Adventure number one, you have to collect some fungus. No big deal, you just need it to heal somebody up, or an alchemist just says, I need some fungus. But what your players do not know is that not only is it poisonous to touch, it's dangerously hallucinogenic. So how I would run this is that over the course of a day, you are making defensive rolls, saving throws or whatever, you add them up, and after a day of harvesting fungus, after it's had time to enter into your bloodstream, suddenly, bang, the more you have failed, the more massive hallucinations you are going to have, the more poison that is going to be in your system. And then you have like a weird tripped out adventure where surreal visions of your enemies are coming at you. This is a good time to bring in PC backstory elements. Ah, my master who I betrayed. Fears that your characters might have had. So that's a bit of fun. But then you have real monsters attack at the same time who are very, very cross that their spawning grounds, their children who are the fungus, have been disturbed. Use gibbering mouthers. I love them. Number two, you have to collect a living fungus monster. Now in D&D especially, there's loads and loads of fungus creatures, but you could also use this for Shadowrun or Call of Cthulhu, whatever. And pick one, and you've got to go and you've got to bring that back alive. Now it's always tricky to capture something rather than kill it, and a fungus monster might need very, very specific conditions to exist in, so you need to recreate those. And if you take it out of its environment, it's very easy for it to die. So this might be an adventure that requires a fair amount of planning. You've got to keep it alive, and you've got to make sure that things that want it to stay in its ecosystem don't take it back. And then, 6 months later, rangers and druids come after you. Why have you messed up our ecosystem? Or, 6 months later, why is there a gigantic fungus smashing the city? That looks like the fungus we took, didn't it? So, yeah, bring him back alive. With a giant mushroom. With laser eyes. Number three, The biggest living creature on Earth is called the honey fungus. It's about 10 kilometers square, 5x5, about 3.5 square miles for Johnny Foreigner. It weighs about 35,000 tons. And think about what a landscape like that would look like filtered through a fantastic world. Give it a dim, malevolent sentience. Fill it filled with monstrous fungal creatures, huge, malevolent treants, ants. Make everything poisonous and itchy, and you have got a fun, gross dungeon. And if you think about the film, and better yet, the book Annihilation, you might have a look at what this kind of profoundly twisted, strange landscape looks like, where everything is alive and everything is horrible. Fill it with loads and loads of cool fungus monsters. Number 4. A witch, or an evil psychic, or an enchantment magician, has taken what Terence McKenna might call a heroic dose of mushrooms to fuel the magic, and unfortunately, it's worked, and suddenly everyone in the nearby environment, your town or whatever, your community, has been sucked into the dreams of a mushroom. So you have to go and find out what the mushrooms want, you have to go and find out if you can help the shaman, help the witch, and then you need to go and negotiate through a surreal dreamscape that is the dream of a fungus. And what is it that fungi really, really like? Well, they really, really like decayed animal meat to grow in. So you can make it that you need to make friends with the fungus, or you can make it that the fungus is a genuinely inhuman alien threat that has no use for humanity except as a seedbed. Brr. Number 5, fairy rings. You have to find an entrance into the Fey Lands, and a ring of mushrooms is the best way to do it. Maybe you need to go and find one. That could be a little mini-adventure in yourself. Grow one. And then when you get into the Fairyland, maybe if you ever wanted to do a Lewis Carroll whimsical hookah-smoking caterpillar, this would be a good time. Although I would do it that you have entered into a Fey Land that has somehow become possessed by or infected by something that's creepy and rotten and wrong, some terrible fungal intelligence. So you need to go and save Queen Mab or the gentleman with thistledown hair or whatever from some genuinely supernaturally powerful fungus. And I think that would be a really, really quite disgusting adventure and frightening adventure, because you're already in Fairyland, which has its own rules, and you're in a Fairyland that's even more malevolent than useful. So there you go, 5 broad bits of folklore. 5 weird fungi related adventures. I need a shower because I suddenly feel really, really itchy and creepy. So I'm Christian, this is Crowland. Please give us a like, give us a share, tell your friends, and I will see you next time.